Welcome to Serving Your Market as Kings or Queens. If you are looking for an interesting commercial, marketing, and sales podcast that is bold, unfiltered, unconventional, and authentic, you are at the right place. Curious how to play the game better and smarter? We will share how we crack the code to hyper growth for our customers. We will invite amazing people. We will share our experience, the first attempts in learning, cracking the code, and finally the results. And last but not least, we will give you food for thought. Now, let's get started.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of our podcast, Serving Your Market Like a King or Queen. And today we welcome Zeno Panhuyzen. Welcome, Zeno.
Thanks, Jeroen. Great to be here.
Hi, Lisbeth. Right.
Hi.
Cool. So, Zeno is a sales leader in SaaS for already more than 10 years. He's currently fulfilling a role at Fuel50. He's the father of two kids. So, next to helping clients, he has a busy personal life as well, I guess, with with two kids. I can only rely on that. I think you as well, Lisbeth, right?
Oh, yes. Yes.
So, he has a background in HR and sales. He worked for several HR tech companies in the past 15 years. So, a substantial track record there. He supported global sales companies with leading the commercial teams throughout both growth as well as expansion. And his main professional focus areas are people development, sales strategy and processes, sales leadership, and development. So welcome again, Zeno. And we look forward to a great conversation with you.
Yeah, thanks for having me. And indeed, yeah, father of two kids, especially during the lockdowns, that was maybe a challenge, like for all the parents that that needed to shift between personal and professional life. But next to that, it's more fun than it is a burden. But thanks for having me. It's great to be part of your podcast today.
You're welcome. All right. So what we'll be discussing today, right? So what is actually the promise of this podcast? So today will all be about how growth and happiness play a crucial role in a competitive edge. So a topic which is, I think, quite accurate in line with the whole developments around the world. So super excited to speak with a sales leader with such a substantial track record and a view on this topic together with Lisbeth. So thanks again for being our guest. So, but before we go into the conversation, we obviously always have our drink, right? So what are you having, Zeno, today?
I came prepared. I have a glass of white wine here with me. One of the habits that I treasure and that also got me through the pandemic. But no, after work, I really enjoy a glass of white wine. So what is nice. It that you're drinking?
I think you are not the only one, by the way. Getting you through it. Well, I have a very fancy glass here, I believe. I've been in France a couple of weeks ago, so I bought some new glasses for champagne. But at the moment, I'm having a cava, but brewed nice. In the traditional way, like they make champagne. So cheers.
Great.
As usual.
For me, I've handpicked a special beer for this conversation. It's called Valhalla. It's from an Amsterdam brewery. It's a bock beer. And if you like special beer, the October they will call Bocktober. So I thought this was good for having this today. So it is a full flavor. It's quite a heavy one as well. So I'm not sure I will do a lot of work after this this podcast. But it has a taste of chocolate, caramel, and dried fruit. And I thought also the link a little bit with And growth and happiness is such an environment. It almost looks maybe like a Valhalla, but I think we can actually make it a reality. So nice. That was my choice for today. So cheers.
Cheers to that.
Cheers.
So my question, my first question to you, Zeno. So if you look at What you're doing right now, I think you're fulfilling a very great job at a cool company as well, where I think purpose comes perfectly together with the business objectives of the company. But if you look at where you are today, so what are the most important milestones maybe in your life?
Good question. So if I go all the way back during university, having studied human resource management, that was actually not a choice that maybe looking backwards was really deliberately made choice. It just happened because I didn't know what to do, actually, coming from a family where a lot of people were in, including my parents, were both in human resource management.
Oh, wow.
So, the strange thing is that looking backwards, maybe if I had could have made the choice now, what study to do, and give myself advice if I could go back more than 30 years in time, I probably would have done something else. But the funny thing is, I've always stayed in this profession. So after studying human resource management and having worked for some companies in most of them in recruitment and search firms, I've moved into sales, and that so I moved into sales, and that got stuck. I got addicted to sales and to everything that comes with sales and the game behind sales, and gotten really good at it. So after that, I've worked for several sales organizations where I was more on the client side than on the on the employee side. And I think for everybody, at some point in your career, you are within an organization, or you're working for a manager, or you're working for a team that really is giving you a life-changing experience. And for me, that has been the years between 2010 and 2018, when I was with LinkedIn. Having started within the first small group of talent that opened the mainland Europe business for LinkedIn out of Amsterdam, in an organization back then that was just very small, not structured, well-funded though. So we had all the opportunities to take everything that we needed in order to open the region. But going through an organization that went through absolute hypergrowth, from an organization of not even 500 people globally to, over 10,000 people when I left, that has been life-changing. And I really learned the sales profession there in the best possible way, I believe. So I think that for me has been life-changing, and that really got me where I am today, because in an organization that goes through such growth trajectories, and an organization where there was a lot of focus on talent and talent development and on coaching and on continuous giving feedback, that really propelled me from being an individual contributor to a manager, to a senior manager, and leaving the organization eventually as someone that was up to the job of becoming a head of sales. So I think that got me where I am today.
And it's very nice, because the combination of the commercial role you are fulfilling in combination with your HR background, and that's, I think, is a very special combination, specifically because what you see very often, and I'm not saying every company, but that HR is a kind of, they think about the development of the people, the compensations, the salaries, things like that. But in terms of how they can really contribute to the business, that is a kind of different play. And that is what you don't see that often, maybe more in SaaS, but to other companies a little bit less.
Yeah, true. I think if you look at HR tech, then obviously the ideal combination would be someone that has a background in HR or HR related business and in sales, if you are in the sales part of that business. But I think you're right. I think I definitely am profiting when it comes to leading teams and building teams and looking at how I, what my philosophy is behind people development. And I think, yeah, then a lot of the experiences from my background in human resource management come in handy. Yeah, yeah, for sure.
They come perfectly together, I would say.
Yeah.
Exactly. And I think those are, I think when you actually combine these things, it can really bring a strong fundament, right? So, and that probably leads also a little bit into the next part, right? So it's the growth fundamentals where where I'd like to go a little bit deeper on these topics with you. So, what we basically see happening around us, right? Right. We are truly in a new era of business, right? I think it accelerated probably 19 months ago or so, somewhere in March. I think we all we will never forget that moment where we were at that point in time. Over the course of the last couple of months, I think what we really see happening is that we are entering a new era of business, right? Where it's not solely about financial growth and putting the customer at the forefront, but it's truly about companies who want to stay relevant, that have people and happiness as a top priority. Things that we see happening, if they don't act on that, there's a big war for talent. I think in the US, right, they even call it the Great Resignation. It's probably something that it's just a matter of time before that actually also comes across the ocean, as we say, right, from there to Europe. So the time to act on that is actually now, right? So how does this influence the development of your own leadership and skills serving your sales team?
Yeah. Interesting question. So if you look at how the market is currently developing and the impact from the pandemic, I think a lot of companies are experiencing the same issues. And that is that they are more keen and focused on developing their internal talent and more focused on talent retention than they were in the past. In a war of talent, I think the most important asset to a company always is their employees. So in order to keep them motivated, satisfied, and happy by giving them all the opportunities that they're looking for to develop and to continuously grow, I think that is one of the most important focuses for businesses right now. By the way, it's also one of the focuses of what Fuel50 is supporting its clients with. So I think if I look at how that is influencing my personal development, it triggered me to get out of my comfort zone for sure, mm-hmm. you know, to think more broadly about, okay, what is it that the teams actually are in need of? What is it that I'm personally in need of? How can I create, and I think this was also always something in my focus, but mm-hmm. how can you create a culture of continuous learning? And talent mobility. How do you provide an organization with the tools in order to give people access over their own career trajectory? And I think steering my own teams, I think was mostly around that topic as well. Really understanding what is driving the people in your teams. What is their why? You know, what is their purpose? Why are they here? What brings them to work every day? What are their personal values? And how can you relate them back to your company values? I think all of that makes that people are finding a sense of belonging, what to me personally is very important if you are building your company future-proof.
Yeah, I think those are great concrete examples, Zeno, especially because we've been speaking over the course of the last, year or so, Lisbeth and myself, with a lot of commercial leaders, and I'm now exaggerating, right? But probably 2 years ago, the element of the paycheck was an important thing, right? Paycheck title. And that is still there, right? But things like commercial togetherness, right? A sense of belonging, an environment for development and learning, that you can make impact while having fun, those types of things that are, that's now a way broader balance, right? And I'm intrigued by how you started to explore that for yourself as well, and started to have conversations with your team around that, right? Because people need to leave their comfort zones, right? I think that's pretty straightforward. Otherwise, nothing will happen.
No, that's for sure. And I think people also became more explicit about what it is that they're looking for in their careers.
Yeah.
A very important a part of that success is actually your managers themselves. I think if you are managing managers, I think this is a crucial focus area. In my experience, the best performing teams are led by leaders who create a growth environment by leading people that eventually are growing outside of their current role, and maybe even eventually growing outside of higher than their own manager is continuously developing and being up for eventually doing greater things. And I think you're not leading to the best of your capabilities if you're not willing to continuously develop your people, and you're not afraid that you have people in your teams that maybe eventually will be looking after your own position.
Exactly. That is exactly. Yeah.
And I think that is my belief of good leadership, that your time in a company is just for a small period of time. You said 2 years, maybe it be 3, 4, 5 years, depending on what type of position you are, or if you're capable of moving from one role into another, but eventually you're going to leave the organization. And I think one of the best lessons I've ever learned, that was in LinkedIn, by the way, was in the first day that we've actually entered the organization and we had our onboarding done in Dublin at that time. Our HRD had a welcome, and the first thing she said that she wanted to discuss with us how we were going to leave the organization eventually when our time was there.
Wow.
So already discussing that lifetime deployment is not there anymore. Huh? We're going to be partners for a couple of years, hopefully, and we're going to make the best of it. And as a company, we're going to profit from it. You will profit from it because you will develop and you will leave the organization as a better professional version of yourself. And I think that is how you these are the types of conversations that you should have with the people in your team when you're talking about development.
Yeah, and I think it's very interesting because at the end, this is also brand experience. Instead of course, how you say, attracting and retaining talented people, but what you're saying, there always comes an end to it, you know, or there is not a position that fits, or they have other kind of ambitions, or just something else, you know, different environment. But at the same time, if you're really providing that learning environment and maybe also providing servant leadership style as a company, that is, that will leave a very good brand experience. These people will probably be your advocate as well in the market, saying how cool that brand is, like how you are talking at this moment about LinkedIn. You know, you tell very positive about the experience you had as an employee. And I think maybe this is also, if you look at playing the game differently, I think if you combine these things together, that this is also where you can take competitive advantage, because you have a kind of innovative DNA. Mm-hmm. You constantly think about, you know, how can you serve your employees, etc. So what is your view on that? Do you believe that growth and happiness will give that competitive advantage, as an example, maybe to your team?
Yeah, no, for sure. I think a couple of things that you've already mentioned. One, I think you want to create talent magnets within your organization, whether that is the manager, preferably he or she will need to attract the best talent and keep and develop the best talent. But also your employees as a whole, they need to be, that's why I'm a strong fan of referral hiring. They need to be in such a good place to develop themselves, to be happy, but there's, maybe it's good to refer to, I listened to a podcast from one of my favorite podcasts, besides yours, of course.
But
it's a podcast, Masters of Scale, from Reid Hoffman. I don't know if you ever listened. He's the one of the co-founders of LinkedIn, by the way.
Okay. Cool.
I wanted to bring that in because he in his last podcast he discussed the 5 secrets of keeping your best employees, and for me that was really spot on. The first one is be uncomfortably authentic. So be authentic as a leader and as an organization is one of the most important drivers for success. And allowing people to be authentic and be themselves, and not forcing somebody to be someone or act as someone that is actually way out of their current comfort zone. I think that's crucial. The second one was show your team trust by giving them space. And this is also something that I've put into practice, giving people mandate. I think, especially if you are managing managers, one of the worst things you can do is continuously overrule your managers if you are not fond with what decisions that they're making or whatever. If that happens, then it's as a leader, then it's actually my fault, not their fault. And you need to give your people mandate to act as an owner. You want them to act like an owner of their own business and maybe a part of ownership of your own organization as well. Celebrate success, which is obvious, but maybe not always done in the best possible way. So I think you need to celebrate and even celebrate failure. You know, if you're gonna want to learn from your failures, I think I've worked in teams where we celebrated the best mistakes from the week. You know, on Friday with a beer, and I really love that still. And I think it's an important part of building the culture that I believe is most successful. And then invest in the team's well-being in a real way, which means that you need to lead by example. That you need to create people that are happy, that are also financially stable. That is also something that you can do that, for instance, by having a good option scheme or whatever, by giving people that also financial part of ownership over the organization. In what I really love in companies that I've worked before, and I hope we can do that in my current company as well, is that we had an hour or a day per month where we invested not in business, but in personal development or in charity or whatever. That really also gave a sense of belonging and to really step out of your commercial role and do something good, give back to community. And I think then the most important thing was that he addressed was investing today's and tomorrow's leaders. That is, for me, the most crucial asset of building a successful organization and managing your people. You need, through mentoring and through coaching and continuous development, continue to focus on build on your leadership skills. So for me, that was actually spot on. If you think about what I believe the competitive advantage is, well, all of that, make sure that you genuinely invest in your people in the best way possible. I think on top of that, if I look at what I believe is important in development, I think talent mobility is also a key part to that. The most successful organizations are those organizations that have a structured way of moving people throughout the organization and really giving them the opportunity to identify what other development opportunities there are in the organization, and then find support from managers or peers in order to identify what those development opportunities are and how they can access those. And I think many people always think that moving up the ladder is always a vertical way up, while moving horizontally or maybe doing a step back in order to make two or three steps forward eventually is something that an organization really should encourage. And I think that's also a big part of the success factor.
Yeah, thanks for sharing that, Zeno, because I think that last part is particularly interesting, especially because the togetherness element, we hear that a lot as well, right? Instead of having separate entities in your organization. And I think the example that you give, like the specific learning opportunities outside of your department, will significantly increase that. We all know I'm not sure what the English term of it is, right? But if you're fresh from college, then you can do like a 2-year internship or something like that, right? And, and that is the thing. But why shouldn't that stop, right? While now togetherness is far much more important, and you should get the opportunity to learn and develop yourself throughout the organization. I think that's it's a very interesting one, and I was not familiar with the term talent mobility, so But I think you described it very well, and I instantly already see the value of that. So thanks for sharing that.
Yeah, it's all also what we do within Fuel50 currently is through technology and in our case through an opportunity marketplace, give organizations the ability to really increase cross-functional and cross-departmental and cross-regional collaboration. And the big upside of that is that you create an improving an environment of innovation, because if people are better working together, and especially in organizations that are very decentralized or organizations that have locations throughout the globe, sometimes you don't even know what opportunities exist in the other side of the world, right? Or maybe in another office in the same country. By visualizing that and really taking advantage of that, you get a huge competitive advantage as well, because you are driving innovation. It has a positive impact on retention, because you're really supporting your people with giving them the opportunity to develop. And for me, that all leads into the culture that I'm trying to achieve, and that hopefully the organization that I'm working for is also creating, where better never stops, where people always are looking to become a better version of themselves.
Yeah, I like that one. Better never stops. So I think we used a little bit in the past, the finish line is always moving, something like that. Mm-hmm. But I think we know the drill, right? So,
I also would like to add on, or just something I'm thinking about, if you talk about, you know, that ever learning mindset, and also that's providing that environment as an employer. I can imagine when you're talking about internship or a trainee programs, that it would be cool that it doesn't matter, you know, let's say you're very happy in sales, but how cool would it be that every quarter, maybe you have a day that you have a kind of trainee day, for example, on the customer success department or finance, whatever, because you see, then you are able to connect all the dots and how important it is, how you at the end work together in processes and, you know, delivering your services and experience to your customers.
The good thing is we did this in one of my previous companies. Okay. We did it once a quarter. So every quarter we had a quarterly business review where for one day all of the business entities were coming together and we were sitting there with marketing, with sales, business development, client, customer success. And the idea was born there during that meeting that we, for once a quarter, every sales leader to start with, and eventually we were picking people from the teams as well, was doing one day in a different team. So as a sales leader, I spend one day in the client success team handling client calls and client requests. And the good thing about this was that you really get a good sense of what is actually happening throughout the entire food chain in the company. And it really spiked the internal collaboration and got better understanding for people how difficult it's sometimes, especially in sales. You know, sales is very demanding, obviously. And because in sales, you are the person that eventually gets, you have a quota to make. Mm-hmm. But you are heavily depending on so many different factors throughout the entire organization that will need to support you and your prospects or your customers in order to be successful. And if you don't know what it is that they're actually doing and how challenging that sometimes is, or what the challenges even are that they're facing throughout that process, how can you collaborate in the best way possible? So yeah, Lisbeth, to your point, I've done it, and it really, really works. And I would.
So
really,
we have a great
everybody.
Tip here for our listeners.
Yeah, for sure.
Easy to implement with a big impact.
Yeah, exactly. Noted. Mm. Noted. So obviously, you mentioned also, right? It's a couple of things: the why and the purpose. Newer generations probably even more than the previous ones, right? They're looking for more than an income and so on. So it's critical to obviously start bringing that into practice, right? With core stakeholders. Could you tell a little bit more, maybe, about your approach to that? For example, around coaching and mentoring.
Yeah, sure. I think what you just mentioned is interesting. If you look at newer generations in the workforce. I think they are indeed looking for more flexibility, and when it comes to work, for more transparency in the culture of a company. They're not just focused on making money or all of that. It's far more that they want to have a sense of purpose and belonging, and they want to continuously develop. And if you really want to put that into practice, I think the key stakeholders that you need to work with, or that I worked with in the past, it needs to be top-down driven. I think that's the first thing. It cannot work if it's just one manager or one team in the organization that is trying to make change. Change needs to be driven, preferably out of the CEO of an organization. He or she needs to be, in an ideal world, very inspiring in delivering that message. And I think the best organizations that do that have, for instance, working with OKRs, where they have their company OKRs that are saying, this is what we want to be as an organization, this is what we expect, and this is these are the actual actions that come out of this that needs to lead to these outcomes.
I have a question around this, Zeno. Maybe your experience, or at least point of view on this. Let's say there is a sponsorship from the CEO, right? And sometimes, hey, you need to start change or transformation in a pilot as such, right? So at least that's my experience with a lot of things. What is your point of view or experience with changing this, but then specifically just for one department, that's more like a pilot sponsored by a CEO?
Well, I think, by the way, that's always a good idea to pilot it first before you roll it out throughout the entire organization. But I think then again, you need to think of, first of all, what is your business strategy? What is it that you're trying to accomplish? And then how does that strategy translate into process? So what type of process is needed in order to make it work? What do people need in order to understand that process? So in other words, what type of learning and development practices are necessary in order to roll that out, and what training or whatever is needed? And then how do you measure the results? And what's in it for the people that are involved? Again, also here, you really need to explain the why. Why is it that you're trying to create this versus the current situation? I think that really gets people on board. And yeah, I think piloting it is a great idea. So I think, and then eventually it needs to be led by senior leadership, right? And it starts maybe with the CEO, but eventually every piece of the organization will need to adapt and need to jump in. And I think then identifying what is needed, what skills are required in order to make this happen. I think
those are the critical components, right? At least, and the right thread to start it with. So, you have had experience there, right? I think you expressed as well. Failing is necessary to innovate, right? I think I was inspired. What is it? 4 years ago or so, when I was at the summit, and someone said, "Fail for me stands for first attempt in learning." So that's what we also adopted. So, what is your first attempt in learning that you could share about actually your experience that you just shared? So,
It's a good one. I think, and I need to go back maybe when I was a first-time manager, when I was really young and learning what it meant to be a manager, I was very results-driven. I think that's also something that, especially if you are starting in a sales organization, maybe in a small organization, small company, where the focus is really on bottom line revenue. I think what I've learned is how important it is to build diverse teams in the first place. I think I had a senior sales executive that was really vocal about how he made mistakes in the past about hiring too many people that were like himself, because that's comfortable, right? Especially when you're young, then it's very comfortable to surround you with people that have the same way of thinking, maybe the same background, the same way of doing business. And I've learned the hard way that is not the recipe for success. So building a diverse team, and not only diverse in terms of male, female, but also diverse thoughts, diverse backgrounds. Why if you maybe this is a bridge again to the mm-hmm. skills driven talent development, but you don't always need to hire people that have a university degree in order to be the best possible candidate for a role. If someone has shown that the way that he or she has developed throughout the years and how adaptive he or she is for change, that can be an even better recipe for success than someone that has a very impressive set of
I can fully agree with that. I personally have a academic thing, as I call it, but it's all about how are you learning, continuous learning, right? If someone has done an academic thing and then have never done any additional learning on the side, that's irrelevant. When I graduated, digital marketing was not even part of my master. So can you imagine if you stopped
learning? It didn't exist.
No, but and that is so true. You know, the world is changing so fast. Can you imagine what the world will look like in 10 years from now?
Yeah.
And as an organization, to prepare for that, you know, it's incredibly important to look at what skills do we need today for certain roles in the organization and what skills will be required if we fast forward a year or two or 3 years from now, and how can we support first of all our employees with developing towards those changes, and how can we future proof our organization by making sure that by the time these changes are actually becoming reality, that we're ready for it.
Yeah.
And I think again that done by continuous development, I think to answer to that question, my first attempt to learning, I think also really understanding and appreciating the gift of feedback. I think mm-hmm. it's very difficult sometimes to get to give and to get feedback. And if it's not done in the best way, then maybe the intentions were good, but then it doesn't come across as feedback, or comes across as very negative maybe, and it has a counter mm-hmm. wise effect. So I think that's that is something that I've learned. And for me, having worked for managers in the past that maybe weren't making the best of it, the managers that really were standing on the sideline dictating what people needed to do, I strongly believe in managers that are leading by example. And I was very lucky to have worked with managers over the past 10 years that really did that were always had an answer to the questions that clients were asking, really were understanding what the market, how the market is developing, what the competitive advantage is. And with that, supporting you in continuously becoming a better salesperson. I think for me, that is that has been a crucial lesson. And I'm trying to be that person on a daily basis in the best way possible.
Yeah, nice. It's all about aspiration, man. Thanks for sharing it, Zeno. I have two small questions also on this topic before we probably go to the next part. But it's so one is around just you have extensive experience also, as you shared, right? Helping the organization and their people to really develop and define their why, making sure that it's also connected to the results that you want to drive, but that there's a corporate strategy. But what will actually happen if the strategy is not connected to the processes? What will happen then?
Yeah, well, that's a good question.
Because we can have great leaders that are walking with you, right? They're not sitting on the side. But if there's a great strategy and it's not connected to processes.
Yeah. Well, speaking of, I have an example of where actually this happened, where the strategy was changing almost every quarter or every 6 months.
Very fluid.
And in this particular case, it was also not that strange because it was in the beginning of the COVID pandemic, where we had to adapt the strategy mm-hmm. on a continuous basis because we saw that revenue was declining. We saw that the market was changing. We saw that maybe even our ideal customer profile was changing mm-hmm. rapidly because of And then if strategy changes and you cannot adapt or amend your processes at the same time in the best way possible, then the motor is getting stuck. Mm-hmm. I say that the motor runs dry.
Yeah. And you get sand in the motor or something like that.
Exactly. Yeah. and this was a very, an example. You won't find this very often because hopefully this was the only time in my life where we had to experience something like a pandemic like this. But I think many organizations are struggling with translating strategy into processes. And you really have to give this a lot of thought. And you also have to remember that there's a process for almost everything. To really get that streamlined, you need to have ownership somewhere in the organization to look at this. For me, in the organizations, the most successful organizations where I've worked or partnered with, that was sales operations. The team that actually sits between your commercial teams and your financial and business intelligence teams. And they need to own these processes. They need to make sure that everything stays and becomes measurable. And that you can really, when it comes to SaaS sales, build that predictive a sales machine, that you know that what you need to put in where in order to get the right outcome. And I think every organization eventually, when growing, will profit from installing.
Yeah, should have a form of operations, right? Whether it's sales operations, or seen our customer operations, growth operations, revenue operations, but a form of operations is crucial. Because like you said, if you want to drive a change with the strategy, you throw sand in the motor, then you will probably... not come too far.
No.
One other question on this topic. Let's say your CEO or of the company now or somewhere else in your career is asking you, "Hey Zeno, I'm just curious. I just want to make sure that. So, does people and happiness actually have an effect on achieving targets more easily?"
Yes. Full yes. Yeah. You need to have happy people and people that are happy in their role, feeling appreciated in order to make them successful and let them make you as a team and as an organization successful. I think results are all driven by an inclusive culture. So make sure that everybody feels appreciated, that everybody plays their part. Again, talent development there is for me a crucial element of this. For me that is, there's no other way than making sure that your people are happy and people feel a sense of belonging in order to bring their best to work.
Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah. If we take a jump to the future growth, so although your experience and your education is in HR and you're working in a company who's providing HR software tooling, if I may say it very in a general way, if you're looking at the combination, so what are the top priorities then for the company you're working for currently, Fuel50, as they have funded for Series B? And how do you connect meaningful commercial metrics to build that success in combination with your own purpose and beliefs, etc.?
Yeah, good question. So I think the top priorities for the company are, and that's also why we now are building the team here in Europe, is to unlock the potential in EMEA. It's starting with Europe. And we've seen a lot of traction over the last year and a half from those people that were already here working out of the European region, that companies are very perceptive for, this conversation that we're currently having, what is necessary in order to prepare yourself for the future? And how do you build a company that really has talent mobility and talent development as a core practice? That's what we do, what we support them with. So the company focus with that will be on growing the team here. So that's the main priority. Next to obviously continuously developing the product. And my experiences from the past is when you are working for a company that is from outside Europe, that these organizations sometimes will need to have some time before they understand that Europe is not just one country, but that there's a whole set of countries with different, cultures and all of that. So having your go-to-market strategy ready for the UK doesn't mean that it's a copy-paste when you want to move into France or even
so
more south.
True.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. We know all about it.
We have experienced that the hard way as well, right? Lots of fails.
Yeah. So I think that is also my and the team's in Europe biggest priority to really understand and support the organization with creating its strategy while we are expanding through Europe. So I think that's the, and for me personally, and that is still something that I'm still actually developing. What is your ideal customer profile per region, and what is actually necessary in order to tap into the full potential? I think for every organization, having your ICP is crucial in order to build your strategy. But especially when you are still redefining your go-to-market strategy in a new region with so many green fields, I think the trap would be just to go after everything that is out there. you need to focus, and from exactly. that focus, with that focus comes strategy.
I can imagine.
Strategy comes focus.
Yes, and what you're saying, it is so important because when you're talking about that ideal customer profile, instead of only looking at demographics and geographics, it is so important that you really find that DNA match when we talk about DNA of your company, that you find a match with your future customers, because they will be the ones that bring the highest value. And I'm not only talking about revenue, but also in terms of happiness, building relationships. Yeah. So you go in there for the long term.
Yeah, for sure. I think and these are metrics that are just as important as well, all the sales metrics that you would track in any SaaS sales organization. But really tracking employee NPS and really tracking how your people are all developing, really tracking what skills are within your organization, and from a learning and development perspective, are there any trends that we can identify within the organization for maybe a lack of skills or maybe skills that we need to develop? If we look a year or 2 years ahead, I think these are metrics that become more and more important for organizations to focus on.
Do you also consider metrics connected to transformation?
That's a good one. I would love
this one is a surprise, isn't it?
I would love to. In one of the organizations where I've worked, we've done that to some extent, that there were metrics where from a leadership perspective, looking at the old-fashioned 9-box grid, looking at who was positioned where. In terms, we had a kind of a similar model where we looked at personal development, where we said, okay, this is where you are in the beginning of the quarter. This is the development plan that you have with your manager, and these are then the goals and objectives that we set for the quarter or for the year. So, but it wasn't really structured. I would love to see something like that. Part of it, by the way, is in the tool that Fuel50 has developed, but maybe not in to that extent that like you just described. I would love that. Yeah.
Something to consider. Yeah. With the planning for 2022 coming up.
Yeah. Noted.
Okay. Cool. And then, well, our final question to you is, Zeno, because we really love that one, because it always gives you some insights of our guests, is what is still on your bucket list?
Well, I have one thing that I really would love to do once, and I have no clue yet what, how and what, and what the topic should be, but I'd love to do a TED Talk.
Cool.
We can shake hands here. Maybe we can do it together.
Yeah. Oh, is that one of your bucket lists as well?
Yes, nice. Absolutely.
Yeah. No. I love TED Talks, and I watch them so often, and sometimes they are so inspiring. And I always think of, okay, what topic do I then need to pick? Or so I'm not there yet, but I hope that one day I can actually put that into practice.
And let us know, because we will watch, of course.
Yeah,
we'll be there in the audience.
We will be there in the audience, cheering. it all started here in the podcast.
Yeah. I'll refer back to this this video.
Yeah, exactly. So.
and maybe from a more personal perspective, I really would like to have more time eventually to really see more of the world and take the kids to explore the world in a way that I haven't been able to when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
So that is something that I hope to provide with over the next 10 years.
Oh, nice. Those are two great things to strive for, at least. And the time element, by the way, and I think that's something which we hear also a lot more. People don't want to work 80, 90, 100 hours or so per week anymore, right? They want to have both me and Lisbeth come from the work hard, play hard, right? Which is ingrained in tech probably and in SaaS, right?
Yeah.
And they try to mask that now with unlimited vacation days who nobody takes, right? Because the culture is not set up in the right way. But the work smart, right? Because you want to have time. Play better because you want to experience also the world. I think that what you actually explain now probably fits very much into that. It's almost like a new paradigm, right?
Yeah, for sure. I think this is one of the maybe the upsides that we got from the COVID pandemic.
Oh, yes, definitely.
By having been forced to work from home and to with force show organizations that it's truly not necessary to have everybody drive to the office every day, be there at 8:30 and leave the office again somewhere between 5 and 6.
Exactly.
Luckily, and I think it starts a lot of tech companies, like you said, are giving that freedom, although the pressure still remains very high. So you can tell somebody you don't have to work 60 hours a week, but if targets are unachievable
and if the CEO is not giving the example, right? If the CEO is never taking off, right? And then Slack is always on. Then nobody will take the 25 days, even less, right? Then they even take less days of their unlimited days, right? So I think it needs to be, people need to start adopting an organization's actually a new paradigm, which is not starting with working for unlimited hours and being present in a place because you need to show that you're working. Those days are over, luckily.
Yeah.
If I compare that to the situation at my current job, where our head office is in New Zealand, which is 12 hours away from where we are, the majority of my team, including my manager, is in the US and then on the West Coast, so that's 9 hours. So in order to find time to sit together as a team, which we luckily don't do every week, but in this phase of this stage of the company, we are still meeting every bi-weekly. Mm-hmm. It requires from most of the European team to log in the evenings, which is definitely not an issue. If you really feel that, first of all, it's appreciated, and the second, that people don't expect you to really give you the freedom to divide your time over the day
and
the evenings, like you feel it best matches your personal life as well.
Exactly.
Again, creating happy employees, especially when you are working with people that are in at that time where they're having young kids and all of that, it's incredibly important to give them that sense of freedom. Yeah,
absolutely. And what you
say, that will help you grow, right? As a company. That will help you grow for your people. It will help your customers. It will help your investors. Everybody will be in a better state, right? So I think that we couldn't close off more happier than this, I would say.
Absolutely. Happy employees will bring happy customers at the end.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Right. So, if we could wrap it up, right? It's just an amazing story how you've told your own milestones and ingrained this into your point of view and your experience. So, we are really grateful for that. Try to wrap it up at least in a sense. So the conclusion of this podcast for me and for us is, the sense of purpose and belonging is first of all, really, really critical for an engaged workforce. It's not something which you put on slide one and in the Netherlands we say hanging on the wall, right? It needs to be ingrained into a mission that you will actually put your people on into the market. It's a key part of your story, where your story is actually becoming more your strategy. So it's all about creating that environment for growth and happiness. To really make sure that you bring that strategy into practice. Yeah, we need to have connected processes to it to make it a reality. Otherwise, it stays like a dream or a purpose or a belonging that is on slide one or for your board or for investors, right? And that's not what we want, right? So thanks for sharing all your inspiration and stories, Zeno. It's really cool. And especially the talent mobility one that was, I've noted that one down. If people want to hear more about that or anything related to this, how can they reach out to you? LinkedIn or email?
Please. Reach out to me on LinkedIn. Send me a direct message. And if you're interested to learn more about my ideas about this, or maybe how the organization that I'm part of is supporting you with that, I'm more than happy to jump on a call. Likewise, thank you. Really, it was really great to be here, and thank you for the invitation, and thank you for the questions. It really got me thinking. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Zeno. It was really a cool conversation.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Zeno. You're welcome, obviously, of course, from me and Lisbeth. And thanks for being an amazing guest. And we hope to see everybody for the next episode. So thank you, and until the next time.
Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye.
Thanks so much for listening to this episode of Serving Your Market as Kings or Queens. If you're enjoying the show, please feel free to rate, subscribe, and review wherever you listen to your podcasts. We really appreciate that effort, and we'll catch you in the next episode.